Close of play on the fourth day of this first test between Sri Lanka and England at Gaul, and we've got a nail biter on our hands. It still favours England, but if you remember and recall, they bowled Sri Lanka out for 135 in their first innings, established a lead of 286 over them. The fact that we've been talking in those terms demonstrates that Sri Lanka have really come back strongly, and they've left England needing 36 more runs to win with 7 wickets in hand. Look, it sounds easy, but if you've been with us for the last hour and a half, you'll know that it is anything but that. Sibley was out playing no shot in the first over for 2, is bowled. Crawley was well caught by Mendes, close in a gully, again off Embledenya, the left arm spinner for 8. And then calamity, Joe Root run out. He collided with the bowler as he set off from the non-striker's end, responding to a call from Johnny Bairstow. Run out for 1, that was 14 for 3. And suddenly that target of 74 seemed a very long way away indeed. Bairstow's played well for his 11. I've loved again the look of Lawrence, the way that he's played, it's the manner which he's played, the smile that he showed when he was facing some balls that were utterly unplayable, was exploding from the spinner and fizzing past the edge of his bat. He just looks to be one of those players who are unfazed. Early days, but it just looks really promising. 359 was Sri Lanka's score, setting England 74 to win. Mixed day for the spinners. Again, they're rusty, but Leach bounced back well to finish with 5 for 122. Don Bess 3 for 100. As Angelo Matthews made a very good 71. Contributions from lots, including Thiramani, who made 111. But setting England 74 to win, bear in mind they started the day 130 behind. So again, you can see that they've shown a lot of character actually today, Sri Lanka. And there we are, 38 for 3, fingernails being chewed. And Michael Vaughan, how about that?
Yes, exciting day's play. I mean, first and foremost, a light for Jack Leach. I thought he got better and better, so a great five for Jack Leach. When you think about the lack of cricket he's had, the rough 12 months or so that he's had in and around the game, he's hardly played any cricket. He played a couple of games for Somerset at the end of last summer here in the UK, around the bio bubble all summer, not getting a game. Then he gets a five for at the first time asking, so delighted for him. Sri Lanka have hung in there. You know, I looked at that partnership, Matthews and Dick Weller. I thought that was a real key moment, and Dick Weller kind of just gave it away with a soft dismissal. Angelo Matthews showed his class, and chasing 74 on a tricky pitch, it's exploding. You do see this often when a small target is being chased. I don't know why, but you do. You always see a few wickets fall, and you know, really pleased for Dan Lawrence to get out there and play the way that he did again, because you know, that's proper test match batting. When you're asked to score runs in those conditions, when the ball's spitting and you've just seen your captain get run out and there's still 60 runs to get, he showed a great deal of character, and Johnny Bairstow looks solid. If Sri Lanka could have run Johnny out just after running Joe Root out, it could have been interesting, because that would have been 14 for 4. But credit Sri Lanka. You know, after day one and day two, we pelted them, and rightfully so, because they were so poor. Days 3 and 4, they've really kind of shown us that they're a team that in their own backyard, they should be able to compete, and they have done.
Just looking at the batting and how you approach batting on a pitch like this, and that smile that he gave, he received an absolute grenade, unplayable thing that spat, took off and everything else. There will be batsmen who are going, oh my word, this is awful, how on earth am I going to score a run out here, how can I possibly survive out here? But it was a smile that he gave to Bairstow that I really thought, you know, this is really promising. It's, yeah, he can just get rid of it. What can I do with that nonsense? Just put it away, bowl the next ball.
Yeah, and that's the mindset you have to have. I mean, Jack Callis is the batting coach, and I'm pretty sure that we all remember Jack Callis was, you know, you never quite understood how cool he was when he batted. He just played every ball, and if one went past the outside edge, it was like, all right, next ball, start to focus yet again. They're good signs for a young player coming into the team when you see that and you see the smile. Joe Root had it when he first came into the England side. I remember when he played one or two of his early innings and the ball was fizzing past his outside edge, he'd smile at the bowler. I just think it's a really good message that you'd be nervous, and I'm certainly sure that Dan Lawrence would be nervous this evening batting, but it's that exterior that you send and that kind of personality that you can kind of come across as in tough, tight situations, which stand you in good stead. So he played nicely. This Sri Lankan team, I mean, Eamon Delia is a left-arm spinner, and I always remember Sakleen Mushtaq saying back in the day that on a pitch that's spinning hugely, The most important delivery is the one that doesn't spin, because you then get into the batsman mind a huge amount of doubt. And you look at Dom Sibley. I do concern myself with Dom Sibley and the way that he's playing spin, particularly left-arm spin. I just don't think his method's working, and I don't think his technique's quite there. You look at Dan Lawrence, he's kind of low, he's busy, he gets that press and he's out to the ball, and then he's right back to that short ball and really kind of uses the blade of the bat, and he goes with the spin. Dom Sibley is very much a leg side player, and if you look at his bat and the way that he sets, so he's almost kind of itching to hit the left-arm spinner on the leg side all the time. His full face of the bat don't come back towards where the ball has been delivered from, and today he just didn't pick up the length of the ball quickly enough, so he went back to a ball that he should have been forward to, and he should have been able, because of his height, he should have been able to get forward and smother that kind of length. So there's a little bit of a technical kind of change that I think Sibley might have to go through to facing the left-arm spinner. And Zach Crawley just made he made an inexperienced mistake. You know, that's what Sri Lanka wanted. The left-arm spinner, go on, drive me. I've got two slips there. It's spinning miles. Go on, just try and push me through the offside. To play that shot against this kind of spinner on the wicket as it's playing now, it's got to be right under your nose. That's where it's got to land, right under your nose. You can't be pushing out at a delivery like that. So just a technical side that Dom Sibley needs to improve upon, and probably just a mental side for Zach Crawley, that you've just got to change the way that you bat on certain wickets. You go back to the first and 20, Dan Stander flick one over the top, probably wasn't the shot for this wicket, and driving in the second innings when it's ragging, it's not the shot on that wicket. So I don't have any concern about Zach Crawley's technique, just his thought process against a certain ball at a certain time on a certain wicket.
Going to interview Jack Leach in a moment. He's just finishing the telly. So a question therefore for Andy Zaltzman, because I want to speak to Jack. Before he bowled, where are we, Shanaka, he had one for...
He was one for 93 after 31 overs. His last spell was four for 37 from 12 overs and five balls at either side of the T interval.
So we can ask him then about that. That'll be good. He'll be with us in a minute. Statistically, I mean, that's South African 73's floating around, isn't it? just for a moment, it looked to be, you know, positively haunting.
Yes, that was a very different match situation. They were chasing a target over 350. Didn't really have a chance. Duru and Pereira took six wickets in that test. Yeah, I mean, if England do fail to chase this down, it would be the lowest unsuccessful chase in terms of, you know, the lowest target unsuccessfully chased in test history. That dates back to 1882, when England failed to chase 85 against Australia.
So just to say that again, this would be the lowest unsuccessful run chase in test history.
Yes, it would. So that run out at 14 for 3,
yes.
That does look an important moment.
Yeah, and it is. It's remarkable how it grips you, how it grips everybody, and the tension that the listeners and the viewers feel, and of course we all feel too. I mean, it's multiplied by thousands by those in the dressing room, and somehow is there somebody there saying, come on lads, calm down, we're going to get this, everything's going to be all right? Or is everyone just sitting on the edge of their seats?
No, everyone would have been sat on the edge of the seats, yeah. Because you know, you lose three wickets so quickly, and then you see Johnny Bairstow that could have been back walking to the pavilion as well. You know, you've got some really experience there in Joe Root and Johnny Bairstow, and you know, 14 for 4, you know, Geoff Butler goes out there and gets out, and all of a sudden you're down to a lot of inexperience in your tail end. You've got Sam Curran coming in at number 7, so yeah, that was a moment for Sri Lanka, and I think they had to have taken that.
Jack Leach, good evening.
You aggers.
Lovely to talk to you. Well done. You must be absolutely thrilled with how you've bowled.
I wouldn't say that, to be honest. I think it's been a hard graft out there, and I've certainly felt I'm probably felt a little bit rusty at times, and felt like I could have done a little bit of a better job. But I think the pleasing thing is I felt I got better as the game's gone on, and hopefully that's a good sign for me.
Yeah, that's very honest of you. I mean, you must be rusty. I mean, goodness me, we spoke so much last summer, didn't we, when you simply couldn't get a game of any sort, and to suddenly to find yourself thrust out there, but not just that, but in conditions which you're expected to just go and roll the opposition out. It's real pressure.
Yeah. I think I put a lot of pressure on myself to do that as well, and, you know, I've tried to give myself a little bit of leeway because, you know, opportunities to play has been limited. But I think when it comes down to it, you still feel you want to do a job. I've certainly found it hard on the body. You can bowl as many overs in the nets as you want, but it's not the same as in the middle when you do put that extra pressure on yourself. I guess you feel it a lot more mentally and physically. So, yeah, it's been a challenge, but hopefully a good one if we knock these final runs off tomorrow.
Always love hearing spin bowlers talk about how hard work it is physically, Jack. Try running in off 30 yards. You're going to speak to Mark Wood.
All right, that's fair enough.
but you're right. I mean, you can't possibly emulate anything in conditions, even the practice games, really, can you, until you're actually out there in a test match?
No, and like our practice game was quite limited, actually. We had one day was rained off, so we only had sort of 50 overs aside, and I think I bowled 8 overs or something. So, you know, it's been a real different challenge with the amount of overs I've had to bowl in hot conditions. And but that's why we play, isn't it, Agus? So yep. It's all good fun.
It is. And looking at the whole winter as such, yeah. I mean, both you now and Dom Bess have got wickets in the bag. You know, you've both been very candid and say, look, hey, we could have bowled better. But you've both got 5 wicket hauls now at the very start of it, and I wonder how important that is.
Hopefully that is important. I think wickets give you confidence for sure, and also long spells, I guess, of bowling and trying to get back into that contest of setting guys up and working out the pace of the pitch and what pace you want to bowl and all those kind of things. So it's been good so far.
Now I hope Jack, that in that situation there's only one person I'd want to see coming out if another wicket had fallen. Had he got them strapped? Were they strapped on? Were you night watch? Are we going to come out?
No, Joss didn't want one. Joss was keen to get out there. So, good on him. I was completely happy with that. And,
I'll bet.
So, yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that would have been okay. But what was it like in the dressing room when Joe Root was run out?
A few nerves. I think it's. I feel a lot happier now with 38 on the board than when that third wicket fell. So, I thought all credit to Johnny and Dan. They played really positively and, scored when they could and kept out the good ones. So, it's always, I think I've played in a few of these sort of tight games on spinning conditions and I've seen it all. So, yeah.
Yeah. How much have you seen of Lawrence, actually? Because he looks to be incredibly self-assured with his batting.
Yeah.
Only 23.
Yeah, I think for a young lad, he looks really mature with the bat. And I think the way he's adapted to these conditions is really great. So he's and his confidence and just the way, even the chats I had with him in the field, he's always looking to help. Obviously, he plays with Simon Harmer, who does really well in for Essex. So. He's been really helpful to me as well. So, yeah, it's been great.
Okay. Last thought, Jack. I mean, you can have a bit of a break now. Clear your head. Come back tomorrow. 36 to win with 7 wickets in hand. It looks easy.
What do you want me to say to that?
Well, you could say, yeah. Or you could say, well, I don't know.
We're coming back tomorrow and we'll knock these off and, then I can actually be happy about my 5 wickets.
Yeah, well, I'm sure that's the case, because it's always nice to take those wickets and win, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. It will only mean something if we win. So, yep, all good.
All right, Jack. Well, look, we're all getting up early tomorrow. Don't take it as an insult if I say I don't want to see you batting tomorrow. Okay.
Yeah, I'm right with you, Agus. I don't want to see me batting either.
All right. You have a good evening. Well done, Jack.
Cheers, Agus.
Thanks for talking to us. Cheers, bye-bye.
Cheers.
He's one of my all-time favourites to interview, by the way, Mark. I'd love interviewing Jack.
Yeah, well, he's had a great time. He's a great character, isn't he? Yeah. I think everyone around the game here in England knows what a good guy is, and Not just because of that innings that he played at Headingley. Obviously, that puts you into kind of cricketing royalty when you do things like that. But just, you know, from, I don't know him that well, but I hear so many things about him that he's just a good guy. So you just wish those kind of people well. And, you know, when you see the year that he had in 2019, for him to bounce back and get a fiver.
Yeah.
And I like his honesty as well. I like the fact that he didn't say...
I was going to say that.
Both
he and Bess have been totally honest about it, haven't they? I mean, you often get people go, oh, yeah, fiver, yeah, did this and did that and bowled really well. They've both said, well, actually, you know...
Well, 41 overs in the second innings, and he did get better and better, and he said it himself, look, I just want a long spell, and that's what he got. He got, you know, long spells, and, you know, you're bound to get better the more that you bowl. But, you know, at test match level, sometimes you can't get the long spells because you don't bowl well enough to stay on.
Yeah.
You know, and that's a sign that he bowled really well because the captain just lobbed in the ball and said, there you go, Jack, you hold that end. And it was the manner of the dismissals. If you go back to the first innings when Don Best got his 5 for 30, you know, cover point being caught and, you know, reverse sweeps, you know, having a catch off short leg, you kind of look at that five and go, I'm not too sure about some of those dismissals. But actually Jack bowled some batsmen out, you know, he bowled them out with good deliveries, nice flight, he was getting some nice revolutions on the ball, and that holds England in good stead for the next game here in Gaul. He'll be licking his lips if this, you know, I can't remember, you were saying it on commentary about the pitch starting on Friday, who knows what we're going to expect, because it can't have been prepared as well as this one, so we could be into kind of what we've seen tonight probably sooner in the game. So the spinners will be licking their lips, as they should be in Sri Lankan conditions.
Yeah. We'll talk to Russell Arnold in a second. We're a bit surprised that he wasn't like watching, actually, because the last thing England wanted was, you know, if a wicket had gone and you've got Butler out there and everyone's jumping about and, you know, you get him out. I was a little bit surprised. I'm not always in favour of night watching, but I thought that tonight might have been a case in point then.
Yeah, but just in the back of the player's mind, it may have been that the umpires might not have... I mean, I do think that there's some stupid rules in cricket. I mean, the spinners are on and the players are in. England were batting for victory. You've got Lawrence and Best who have done all the hard work. You think common sense would prevail and the umpires would go to the batters and say, what do you reckon? You're happy to carry on? And Johnny and Dan Lawrence would go, yes, let's just carry on. We need 36 more runs.
That's
probably why Butler wanted to get out there, just in case he could get it done tonight. And I think that's exactly the right kind of attitude.
Yeah. Well, Russell Arnold, we wondered, didn't we, at tea, what we'd be talking about at the close of play. And you thought, honestly, well, an England victory probably. Well, what a finish.
It calmed down once more, but that start was hectic, wasn't it, Agus?
Yes.
So interesting, it was exciting, and we saw a lot of panic in the England camp for a short bit. But Dan Lawrence and Johnny Bairstow, once they've ridden that early period, have looked like they've got it under control. Now, if you think of the 35 runs, I would think England might have preferred to bat on and finish it off today. Get that extra half hour, but it was not coming because of light.
Yes.
But that would have been the mentality, because tomorrow you have to play yourself in. The bowlers would be a little more fresh, and you just don't know what can happen. It's another day.
It's just so typical, really. It's such a great illustration of how cricket is in your part of the world, isn't it? You know, men around the bat, ball spitting like that and turning and doing so, and how, when you're not used to that, and I'm thinking particularly of Dan Lawrence, how you go out and you cope with that sort of pressure.
Oh, he was very impressive once again, because unlike in the first innings, the second innings was harder. He just lost three in a row, Joe Root coming out, and for him to just be proactive, show some intent, show something different, and try to put some pressure on the Sri Lankan bowlers was very, very good from the young man. Shows that he's got a good head on those shoulders. Of course, the game has changed when he batted in the first innings to the second innings. His scoring options and how he's got to approach it is very different. And he kind of seemed to have that understanding, or was able to adjust to it, which is very, very good to see.
We were talking here, Michael Vaughan and I, about the two openers, Sibley and Crawley, the fact that they haven't looked, they've only batted briefly, of course, and haven't looked comfortable against the spin at all. That'll be something that Sri Lanka will take with them into the second test, regardless of what happens tomorrow.
Yes, they'll be kicking themselves, though, for getting themselves into this situation. And they'll be thinking, if we had a 50 runs more, just like I told you, it's a total different game. So many things happening. And the ball's going to fly through.
you're going to get some runs here and then. You need that cushion. That's what Sri Lanka don't have, and only themselves to blame, because we just keep going back to that first innings. There's no forgiving the effort or the application there, is it?
Just a last thought from you, Russell. Is this one of those, or could this be one of those situations, you think, and we see it relatively often, where although a team loses a match, they actually take a lot with them into the second? And given that the second match is just 3 days away, given the second half of this game that they've had, in which they've actually outplayed England, to be honest, haven't they? Will they go into that game, yeah, disappointed to have lost it, but actually with some momentum behind them?
Yes, there will be belief, there will be understanding that this is what they can do, this is what they are capable of. But they will understand that they'll have to play for longer periods. You're not going to win games by playing in patches, as Sri Lanka have done. It's not only in this game, when you go back over the last few years, that's been the trend. But England have been very good, or good enough, to actually take control of situations or opportunities that have been presented to them. They're batting in the first innings, they went on to make a big score and have put themselves in that situation. So Sri Lanka will understand the game a lot better, because at the end of the day, it's a young bowling attack. I do feel, like I told you yesterday, a change needs to come in. I'm not really sure Sri Lanka can rely on Dilwan Pereira. They might as well use these opportunities to bring in another spinner and make that bowling attack a lot stronger, especially for home test matches.
All right, Russell, I heard a car horn going there. I think your taxi's arrived. time for you to go. Thanks for talking to us today.
Cheers, Angus.
Cheers, Russ. There we go. Russell Arnold, of course. And he's been enjoying the ebbing and flowing of this test match, as we all have. His last thought from you, Michael. This shouldn't go wrong from here, should it?
No. You wouldn't have thought so. I thought that partnership, Dan Lawrence and Johnny Best, and all the history of the game, you know, Stoltz just said it, be the lowest ever chase to be bowled out for. So, no, I think England will get there. They might lose another couple of wickets, but I think they'll get there. But before we go, Angus, I have to say, it's been a long day. And it's not that easy, is it?
A horrible setup. I feel a horrible setup.
No, it's not. No, I'm just saying, it's not that easy, is it? Commentating off the telly.
Here's Leach bowling, and the new batsman's edged it as Root caught him again. Was it sponsor out of the rough? He has another brilliant catch. It's like an action replay, exactly the same. And I don't know what Pereira was doing there, really, to his first ball, apart from his eyes lighting up. Or
it's a replay.
It was a replay. It was a replay. Oh God. I'm sorry, why didn't someone tell me? Oh dear, it goes Leach and Bowles, and that's dropped, I think, in the gallery. Oh God, there's only so many 3 o'clocks a man can take. I said it looked like a replay, and it was. Oh God, you lie down. Here's Leach, and was this dropped? I think it was low down in the gallery. Well, that'll entertain some people anyway. Now that's turned away. This is definitely live.
Yes.
Played out to mid on. I think I should give Tino the job. He'd do a better job.
Oh, no, Johnny. I'll tell you, that was difficult. That was difficult. He's in second. He's played in second. The same shot as his mate.
Shot. The same catch.
Oh, Angus,
to play that again.
No problem. Can we say, in a few years' time, I'm not too sure that we'll be talking about the day's play as much as we're going to be listening to that,
that magnificent
bit of commentary.
Haunt me for a very long time, but there you go. It's fun. Okay, come on. It's ball by ball. It's a laugh. And that's just what our programme's all about. Zoltz, is that the most ridiculous piece of commentary you've ever heard, just statistically?
It's up there. I mean, it was certainly over 300% more ridiculous than the average bit of commentary. So,
why can't they put replay? This is an action replay up on the screen. Why can't they put that up?
Yeah, just put a sepia wash over the screen when it's not live.
It's fair. It was that good of commentary that I was lying back on my chair because you were on with Tuffers.
Yes.
And I sprung up because I thought, oh yeah, you're going to have got another one. Fantastic. I thought, well, surely you can't make the same mistake. It's exactly the same shot.
Right, stop it now. That's enough. We've got a date tomorrow, Michael.
Right, see you at 4:15.
You certainly will. Andy, anything else to add from your perspective down there?
So another quick Joe Root stat. 5 catches in the match, as I mentioned in the commentary. It's 6? No, I think it's 5, isn't it?
No, 6. You got one on the replay.
Oh, sorry, Angus. Yeah. Yeah, I haven't included that in the stats yet. And a double century. Only five players have ever had a double century and five catches, and only three of them have not been wicketkeepers. Keith Fletcher, Jack Callis, and now Joe Root with that double century and five catches. 47 catches in his last 25 tests. That's the most by an England fielder in a 25-test sequence. And just to repeat that thing on Emble Denier, one of only four bowlers in the history of Test cricket to dismiss both opposition openers in single figures in both innings, and the first spinner to do so.
Lovely. Thanks to all of you. Thanks to everyone who's been up again this morning with TMS, and I know you're all enjoying it, which is great, and that's what it's all about. So we have a date tomorrow, do we not? 4:15. Come on, let's see what's going to happen, because this, well, it could be a jangler. 38 for 3. England needs 36 to win this first test match. The podcast is available shortly via BBC Sounds, and of course there's more analysis on the BBC Sport website and the app. You can hear the fourth day of that intriguingly poised Australia-India test at the Gabba from 11 o'clock this evening. Commentary starting online with Sports Extra joining at the conclusion of the NFL. And then there we are. We're back on air tomorrow. 10 past 4. Come on. You can't miss it. It's the morning of the fifth and final test of the Gaul test, with England needing 36 to win. We'll see you, promise me, tomorrow morning, 4:15.